virtual, it's long distance. It's from the comfort of our couch. Yet, our classrooms continue to echo with the sound of music, rustling strokes of paintbrushes, laughter, and lively discussions, making the textbooks come alive.
Talk about our enriching journey of Funcar, a week-long festival at Shivnada School, Faridabad, which brings out the artist in each student through integration of arts with scholastic subjects.
Art fosters the culture of collaboration, creativity and free thinking. It makes learning matter by giving us a medium to connect new knowledge to personal experiences and articulate our learning in new and refreshing ways.
Let's start with grades 8th, 9th and 10th sharing their artwork and reflections of their journey during Funcar.
Dear parents and children, the year 2020 has been one of tremendous surprises and surging creativity. If nothing else, it has taught us how to convert stumbling blocks into stepping stones. To sustain a comprehensive online program through these months has been not just challenging, but deeply satisfying. Shivnada School's signature programs such as Joy of Sharing, Award Ceremony, Funcar, have found a robust platform. Nothing really has been left aside, despite the remoteness of collaboration and the distance in between. I'm delighted to share that recently, a group of 5 girls from grade 10, Nirvani, Gurnoor, Arshia, Mansi, and Suhani, made it to the finals of the most coveted event of Shivnada School, the colloquium. The colloquium centers around designing a project from ground zero, scaling it to making prototypes that can be marketed and resolve a social problem with judicious use of technology. They won the first runners-up prize among the 7 finalists of the 3 campuses and faced an external jury comprising people from the industry and came through with flying colors after months of diligent hard work of drafting and redrafting, improving their project, taking inputs from many and just not giving up. Apart from their victory, I am indeed proud of their perseverance and resilience. Needless to say, they did all of this keeping the fine balance between their academics, exams, and the responsibility of a board class student. Today, we bring to you the digital version of Funcar with the hope that you will experience the sense of joy and exuberance that the children have felt in stitching this together for you while being in their homes, removed by distance, but aligned by the same ethos, artistic bent, appreciation for beauty, and love for each other. Students of grades 8, 9 and 10 have worked on their art projects, blending it with scholastic domains. You will witness some serious work here. For instance, a group of students worked for over 3 months building a space station to sustain life beyond our planet. Another group has delved into the concepts of democracy, significant differences between presidential and parliamentary forms, and responsible citizenship. Let the video unfold other beautiful aspects of this integration for you. 2020 has been the greatest teacher of all times. It has reinforced the lesson that life doesn't get easier. We get stronger and fortified each time to convert challenges into possibilities. In the next 60 minutes, I hope you enjoy the work of the children and the teachers who have been their greatest mentors.
Greetings everyone. We, the students of grade 9, integrated our English chapter, The Sound of Music, with Western music. We were really inspired after reading about Evelyn Glennie, who despite being deaf, rose above all challenges to reach great heights as a percussionist. We did an experiment where we used a metronome which only had colors to identify different beat sections. We used the common rhythm, which is a 4-on-4 time signature, and instead of click sound, we used the red color to identify the first beat, followed by 3 sections of green color to identify second, third, and the fourth beat. With the color red on the first beat, we were instructed to play an accented stroke for percussion and an accented strum on musical instruments. It was a self-composed instrumental music by all individual students. The important elements were keeping the correct counts while playing the instrument and following the correct rhythm pattern just by seeing the color sequenced metronome. This experiment helped us feel the same difficulty which Evelyn Glennie must have faced, and to understand that music can not only be played by hearing it, but also by seeing and feeling it.
Thank you.
in this advanced era of space exploration, mankind has made extensive efforts to unravel the mysteries of this universe and surpass its potentials. 12 of us from grades 8 and 9 participated in the quarterfinal round of the International Space Settlement Design Competition held annually at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. This year, the competition organizers from NASA and Boeing put us in the shoes of aerospace industry engineers and challenged us to design Cassandras, the first fusion-propelled space settlement, serving as a space cruise liner and enabling an 80-day transit between Earth and Mars for about 9,000 people. We created a 40-page long report addressing the issues and communicating our ideas and designs. We present to you a glimpse of our space cruise, Cassandras.
Cassandra strives to meet its residents' expectations and attain the highest standards of hospitality with its urban and homely design. Cassandra consists of two primary facets. One is a torus that we call Alpha, and it has an area of over 23,11,347 meters squared, and it houses over 8,000 people. The other one is a cylinder that we call Caligo, with an area of 78,500 meters squared.
Alpha Torus is pressurized and rotating at a speed of 0.8 rpm to create artificial gravity for the comfort of the residents. Caligo, the industrial cylinder, is a non-rotating unpressurized level of the Cassandras. It is further divided into first, second and third floor, consisting of the control area, the storage area and the agriculture area respectively. Alpha and Caligo are interconnected by a central tube with elevator and are powered by using 4,28,572 large solar panels, generating 1,50,000 megawatts of electricity.
Cassandra's operations and infrastructure are the virtues of an entirely self-sufficient settlement, and it meets all the necessities of its residents. The agriculture in Cassandra's is done with the process of aeroponics to provide its residents with the food they all can relish. The atmosphere and circulation is managed by a NASA-inspired self-designed system in which we use numerous processes such as the Sabatier reaction, electrolysis, and fuel cell reaction. The waste and water management of Cassandra's is also done by a self-designed system that works with subcontractors to recycle and reuse as much waste as feasible and making it a sustainable and eco-friendly settlement.
To help our residents cope with their daily lives, Cassandra's provides them medical facilities, educational facilities, and not to mention recreational facilities, both with zero-g and gravity. Along with luxury, Cassandra's aims to connect people with its ingenious open community design. In the residential sector at Alpha, there are total of 4 equally luxurious stator rooms that passengers can choose as per their desire. The residents have a total of 3 rooms of varied sizes to choose from as per their comfort. Airlocks are a way to safely transit from one pressurized area to another pressurized or unpressurized area. Space suits are a necessity in space. We have 9,500 IVA suits to cater out our residents and passengers, and 400 EVA suits which are used to take spacewalks outside the spacecraft.
Cassandra's is undoubtedly very technologically advanced, and mechanized systems are present all around the settlement. For the interior and exterior construction, we use several robots like the Canadarms, the Archinaut and the Refabricator. The data relay satellites allow humans to control or monitor the settlement from anywhere like the ISS or the Earth.
Internet comes to Cassandra's through the data relay satellites and network maps made for the same. Several robots designed by us fulfill different requirements such as surveillance bots, police bots, and fire bots. We designed a control room to ensure the smooth functioning of our settlement.
The construction of Cassandra's is scheduled to take place from the year 2081 to 2100. It is estimated that the total cost incurred by the company will be around $196.5 billion. Business development venues were suggested. For example, renting space for affordable and quicker transport between Earth and Mars, several chargeable activities, and the sale of commodities in the settlement, etc.
In the shoes of space engineers, we had to demonstrate creativity, technical competence, management skills, space environment knowledge, teamwork, and presentation techniques to conquer the problems inherent in designing a space settlement.
We all learned a lot and cherished each step of formulating this architectural marvel. It has indeed been an illuminating and remarkable journey for all of us. We hope you liked our vision of Cassandra's. Thank you.
Louis J. Kaplan said, "Adolescence represents an inner emotional upheaval, a struggle between the eternal human wish to cling to the past and the equally powerful wish to get on to the future." The concept of how do organisms reproduce in biology is incomplete without human reproduction. Human reproduction begins at puberty, which sets at adolescence. Hence, it was important for the grade 10 students to know the changes that happen during this phase and how they can embrace these changes positively. Also, the difference between biological sex and gender was another significant point that needed clarification. What could be a better medium other than theater to express these emotions? Thus, these concepts were woven into stories that related to their age and stage stories of gender that they've heard, stereotypes or taboos that are associated with gender, body positivity versus body shaming. To ensure better participation by the students, all sessions were conducted in the presence of the school counselor, along with the biology teachers and theater teachers. Safe spaces were created for the students for unhindered expression. Students created their own stories, worked on body movements, and did voice workouts before their final presentations. Here is presenting one such story of the many they created.
This is the story of Rani, a young girl in her teens who wanted so badly to play the game of her dreams, something she could only dream of doing on the same level as her male counterparts. The school was not one of bad infrastructure or education, but the one constant was the hollowed mindset sealed into every individual that girls were not good enough.
Hi, I've just moved here and I would like to play with you guys.
You? Will you play with us? No way. We don't want to break your arm and get screamed at.
Okay, but I've played football before. And besides, I'm not weak.
Oh, I'm pretty sure you are. Now go sit and gossip with the other girls. Rani once again marches onto the field, now with a note in her hand.
Here, see? I got a note from the coach to let me play with you guys.
Do you really think we'll let you play with us just because you're a teacher's pet?
Ah, come on, let her play. She'll realize she won't be able to keep up. And fair enough, Rani couldn't play as well as she wanted to. She got some passes here and there, but the ones she missed, she was ridiculed with loud scoffs and screams from the other side of the field.
Hi Rani, how's the school treating you?
It's okay. Just that those kids from the football team won't let me play with them. I don't understand it though. They don't even know if I can play or not. I think I deserve an actual chance.
Yes, you're absolutely right, Rani. But you need to understand that these are young boys and this is all they know. That a girl is a girl and they think she cannot play on the same level as they can. Which is untrue because some of them can really not play. I say that you go every day until they realize that you can actually play.
The coach tells the boys that they will be going to an inter-school football tournament and that this time Rani would go with them. With this in mind, the boys were very confused and didn't understand why exactly the coach was favoring Rani.
Oh, It's just because of the fact that you are a girl that you get all this special treatment. I'll show you on the field, Rani.
As the tournament proceeds, Rani actually plays well. She turns out to be a strong defensive player, unlike what the boys on the team thought. Out of pure embarrassment, some of them decide to apologize.
I am sorry that I teased you, Rani. You are actually pretty good.
She's not that good. I think I play better than her.
I accept your apology. It's okay that you thought I didn't play well. But it's not okay that you thought I didn't play well because I'm a girl. It doesn't matter if I'm a girl, you know. I'm not asking you to ignore the fact that I'm a girl, but instead acknowledge it and move forward. Not make it the only thing I stand for.
This, Rani was now part of the team. There was judgment, sure, but the small victory was everything to her.
कक्षा के कुछ छात्र आपके समक्ष हमारी हिंदी कला एकीकरण परियोजना को प्रस्तुत करने जा रहे हैं। हम टीपू सुल्तान व हैदराबाद के निजाम के बारे में बात करेंगे। टीपू सुल्तान का जन्म कर्नाटक में हुआ था। उन्हें शेरे मैसूर अथवा रॉकेट मैन के नाम से भी जाना जाता है। अंग्रेजों से मुकाबला करते हुए सरिंगापट्टनम में उनकी मृत्यु हो गई। टीपू के द्वारा कई युद्धों में हारने के बाद मराठा और हैदराबाद के निजाम ने ब्रिटिश सरकार का साथ संधि कर ली। चौथी एंग्लो मैसूर युद्ध के समय ब्रिटिश सरकार की शाही बलों को हैदराबादी निजाम ने अपना समर्थन दिया। अब हम एक संगीत उपकरण के बारे में बात करेंगे जो तेलंगाना में बहुत प्रसिद्ध है।
कला का एक ऐसा रूप है जिसकी मान्यता वर्तमान में लुप्त होती जा रही है। किन्नेरा एक संगीत का उपकरण है जिसमें 12 चरण होते हैं। यह संगीत का उपकरण उस पर जुड़ी तारों के द्वारा अलग अलग स्वर व ध्वनियों उत्पन्न करता है। किन्नेरा की उत्पत्ति 4वीं शताब्दी ईस्वी के आसपास डेक्कन प्लेटियों में बताई गई है। चेंचू जनजाति को नल्लामल्ला वन तेलंगाना का हिस्सा था। वह किन्नेरा को बजाते थे और बहादुर लोगों की गाथा गाया करते थे। मूल निवासियों ने पाडुंगा सयाना, एक तेलंगाना सेनानी के बारे में संगीत बनाने के लिए किन्नेरा का उपयोग किया था। अब हम आपके समक्ष एक गाना प्रस्तुत करेंगे। धन्यवाद।
हकीकत को जब भूल गए चारों तरफ अंधियारा था। ब्रिटिश हुकूमत को पहले शेरे मैसूर ने ललकारा था। हकीकत को जब भूल गए चारों तरफ अंधियारा था। ब्रिटिश हुकूमत को पहले शेरे मैसूर ने ललकारा था। मैसूर पर जब आई मुसीबत थी तलवार उठाई मैसूर पर जब आई मुसीबत थी तलवार उठाई आजादी की जान के खातिर उसने देश की कसम खाई। जिस तलवार के आगे भी जिस तलवार के आगे भी गुरों ने शीश झुकाया था। ब्रिटिश हुकूमत को पहले शेरे मैसूर ने ललकारा था। हकीकत को जब भूल गए चारों अंधियारा था। ब्रिटिश हुकूमत को पहले शेरे मैसूर ने ललकारा था। शेरे मैसूर ने ललकारा था। शेरे मैसूर ने ललकारा था।
नमस्कार महोदय व महोदया जी, हम शिव नादर स्कूल फरीदाबाद की कक्षा 10 के छात्र हैं। हमारे समूह में दिया, वीरेन, निपुण और मैं रूजल हैं। हमें इस वर्ष कला एकीकरण के लिए तेलंगाना राज्य मिला। हमने कैफी आजमी के द्वारा रचित पाठ कर चले हम फिदा को मार्गदर्शक मानते हुए एक गीत रचित किया। इस गीत से हम अल्लूरी सीताराम राजू एक तेलुगु सुरवीर के बारे में और लोगों को बताना चाहते हैं। अधूरी सीताराम राजू ने गुदम पहाड़ियों में लोगों को अंग्रेज़ों के खिलाफ लामबंद करने में बड़ा योगदान दिया। ऐसे शूरवीर को हमें सलाम करना चाहिए।
भारत माता के कई सपूत, कोई महात्मा कोई देवदूत, ग्रामों मुगलों में जन्म मानो वीर रूप कहलाए। ना थे वो राजा ना हिरण, इस हुकूमत के विरुद्ध में बजाया उन्होंने दिल में आजादी देखने की आरज़ू कर पड़े यारे सीताराम राजू। तोड़ा हरे रोका पार विमान किया रंपा अभियान करम को गुरु बनाया अंग्रेजों का हृदय कर पाया भगवान का रूप बन के तपस्या से शक्ति पाए शहीद हो गए कर भी वह मर हो गए।
That said, we have panelists from different backgrounds. So let's drop the baton and start our discussion.
Determining how to safely reopen buildings and public spaces under social distancing is kind of an exercise in limit. If each person must keep 6 feet away from everyone else, then figuring out how many people can sit in a classroom or a dining room is a question about packing non-overlapping circles into floor plans. Sphere packing might seem like a topic only a mathematician could love. I mean, who else could get excited about finding the most efficient way to arrange circles in the plane? But right now, to my surprise, millions of people all around the world are thinking about this very problem.
So do we have a solution to that?
Social distancing is important for us politicians too. Our work often includes close interaction to the citizens or other MPs. After all, we have a lot of handshakings to do. As you can see, there are several measures in place to ensure social distancing is followed in the parliament too, such as no more than 50 MPs allowed in the chamber at any given time, and breaks to allow MPs to enter and exit the chamber safely. However, we are always looking for some methods through which this process could be more efficient. Maybe maths could help.
So again, we need a solution to that. Do we have a solution?
Yes. The first way we can pack people in a room with social distancing norms is that of square packing. It is similar to seeing a crate or soft drink can. In it, the centers of the circles are the vertices of the square. Packing density is the ratio of the area used to the total area well. To find the packing density, we first need to find out how many circles are inside each square. As the sum of interior angles is 360 degrees in a square, one full circle can be fitted inside. Next, we divide the area of the circle by the area of the square, taking the radius as half. When we divide them, we get the packing density as 78.54%.
Mr. Principal, you said that square packing has packing density which is 78.54%. Is there a way we could utilize more space?
Yes, yes, hold your horses, Sarnab. Hexagonal packing is the way to go. In a hexagon, all interior angles are equal to 120 or one third of a circle. This means that there are two full circles plus one circle in the middle. Area of the circles divided by the area of the hexagon gives us the packing density, which is 90.69%. Hence, hexagonal packing is very viable for opening schools.
Well, that's a wonderful way of space management. With that said, we have the second topic, which is Math Behind Masks, which will deal with the ever-rising problem of people not wearing masks. I am now going to open the floor for a discussion on the same.
Social distancing, face masks, and eye protection, they all appear to reduce the spread of COVID-19 in both healthcare scenarios and general community. With social distancing, the chances of infection of the transmission of these coronaviruses is about 3% when people kept a distance of 3 feet from each other, compared to 13% when people kept a distance less than that. What's more, if there is an every extra 3 feet, the risk of COVID-19 is reduced by half. With face masks, the chance of infection was 3%, but without face masks, it was 17%, which is a reduction of more than 80%.
So how and why do masks work? When a person has COVID-19, the virus lives at high amount in the nose, back of throat, and airways. Masks serve as a physical barrier to prevent the transmission of mucus and tiny respiratory droplets from one person to another. It cuts down on the amount of virus that you are exposed to.
Hello, class.
Mr. Nagpal, you are not in your class. This is the nation's discussion panel.
Oh, sorry. And I also talk about the math of masks. First, look at this diagram. And assume that all masks are 50% effective. There are four possibilities if you meet an infected person. Either both of you are wearing a mask, neither you are wearing a mask, or one of you is wearing a mask. If both of you are wearing a mask, then chances of getting infected decrease by 50% to 50, or 50% plus 25% or 75%. If no one wears a mask, then chances decrease by 0%. And if one person wears a mask, no matter who it is, the chances decrease by exactly 50%. Is anyone listening? I knew it. No one ever listens to me.
I would like to disagree with Professor Nagpal. You were heard loud and clear. With this, I end this discussion. I hope the nation learned something new. And I would like to believe that this discussion has given us a new perspective as well. Stay home unless it's urgent. Keep distance unless you want to get close to the virus. I am Sarnab and thank you for listening.
Hello everybody, we, the students of grade 8, are the Generation Z, notoriously known for vouching for equality and justice in all areas of life. It makes it all the more imperative for us to be well acquainted with our rights and duties.
Fundamental rights are the rights which are essential human rights that are offered to every citizen irrespective of their caste, race, place of birth, region, or gender. There are six types of fundamental rights: right to equality, right to freedom, right against exploitation, right to freedom of religion, cultural and educational rights, and finally, right to constitutional remedies.
We have not only done it as part of our curriculum, but also through Learning Beyond a Textbook project called AIL. So allow us to delve into great experiences and learnings about our AIL lessons with you.
AIL, or Art Integrated Learning, is a way of learning scholastic topics, but in a fun and interesting way, and making real life connections as well. We learn a subject through art integration.
As part of AIL, we had theatre combined with social and political life. In these lessons, we learned about fundamental rights like right against exploitation, right to constitutional remedies, etc. We attended 5 sessions that broadly covered the following themes: what are my rights? Rights granted, rights denied. With rights come responsibilities, sharing stories and reflections. So let's dive into stories related to our fundamental rights that our students have prepared.
Now, let's watch a skit about right to equality prepared by students of grade 8.
Equality may be a fiction, but nonetheless, one must accept it as a governing principle. As rightly said by B.R. Ambedkar,
the great man we've all heard of. He started in Elphinstone High School and went to school like any other regular kid. However, he wasn't treated like one. He faced discrimination on the basis of his caste, and basic rights like equality were snatched from him. But unlike others, he took a step against it and raised a voice. But his caste, the society, and the stereotypes couldn't stop him from reaching greater heights. Today, we will show an incident that is an example of how he was treated.
Good morning, students. Hope you are doing good. Kindly settle down on your respective seats in the next 2 minutes.
Ambedkar was about to sit with the rest of the students.
Hey, what do you think you're doing?
I'm just sitting here.
With us? Do you even know your place around here?
Yeah, you just can't go around sitting with us.
But this is the only seat left.
What is this commotion about? What did you do, Ambedkar?
I did nothing. I was just trying to sit here, but they are not letting me.
Now, how could we let him sit with us, ma'am? He will sit with us and make us impure. We cannot let that happen.
Yes, you are absolutely right. Ambedkar, sit at the back of the class.
But there is no bench there.
Yes, I am well aware of that. You have to sit on the floor.
Why so, ma'am? Sitting on benches, so why do I need to sit down?
Stop arguing and take a seat at the back.
Okay, ma'am.
This very kid who was bullied and discriminated against by his classmates is now known as the father of the Indian Constitution.
Now it's time to have AIL reflection from few of my friends.
This art integration program was filled with life skills like communication skills, reflection and inquiry skills, unconditioning of the mind leading to a higher confidence level and self-esteem.
When we all were well-versed with the topic, we went into breakout rooms and we made our own small skits where we displayed how rights get violated and how people try to get justice. This session truly made us realize the meaning of the famous saying, justice delayed is justice denied.
I would like to conclude this with a quote. I quote, "Focus on the journey, not the destination. Joy is found not in finishing the activity, but in doing it." I unquote. Thank you.
Everyone, welcome to Fankar 2020. Today, the students of grade 9 Gate and Corbett will be going to present their interpretation of the US presidential elections. We will be starting with a short video that will explain the basics of this election and its process. Next, we have Kamala Harris and Mike Pence, two nominees for the vice presidency of the United States of America, who will be giving their speeches as part of a national convention. To end this, we have a presidential debate where Donald Trump and Joe Biden will be grinding each other to the very last. With this, I would like to say, let the elections begin.
The US presidential election can be divided into 5 parts: primary election and caucus, national convention, general election, electoral college, and inauguration.
There are 2 voting processes for the primary election in America, which are known as primaries and caucus. In primaries, a citizen shows up at a polling booth and casts his or her vote. In caucuses, people attend a debate before they vote for the preferred presidential candidate. States which vote through a caucus process are Alaska, Colorado, Hawaii, Kansas, Maine, Minnesota, Nevada, North Dakota, Wyoming, and Iowa. Now, our classmates will show the Democrats' primary debate for the presidential candidate.
We're going to give back that money to the employee.
As a matter of fact, I will.
Well, let me tell you something. For a socialist, you've got a lot more confidence in corporate America than I do.
You've got to defend the fact that today not only do we have 87 million people who are uninsured and underinsured, you've got to defend the fact that 500,000 Americans are going bankrupt. They're bankrupt because they suffered a terrible disease, cancer or heart disease. Under my legislation, nobody will go into financial ruin because they suffered.
We all know how Trump's been treating the nation, with negativity and nothing else. My fellow Americans have been suffering under him, and I am focused on stopping him. President Trump, you spent the last 2.5 years trying to sow hate and division among us, and that is why we have got nothing done. You used over 12,000 lies as a way to distract from your failed policies and your broken promises.
Looking under Trump's administration, I would like to speak about the license-free use of ammunition and arms. And this is what I would like to say. Hell yes, we're gonna take your AR-15, we're gonna take your AK-47, we're not gonna allow them to be used against our fellow Americans.
I was 6 years old when a presidential candidate said, it's time to pass the torch. That candidate was then Joe Biden. He was right when he said that 32 years ago and is still right today.
Yes, my friend, you are right. I am still holding on to that torch.
National Convention. The Democrats and the Republicans hold national conventions. The formal purpose of a convention is to select the party's nominee for the presidential election. And then the presidential candidate chooses his or her vice president. To become the presidential nominee, a candidate typically has to win a majority of delegates.
Now our classmates will show a glimpse of the National Convention. Did you get confused? To understand this better, we have two speeches lined up by our classmates, Sohan and Aryan, who will be depicting Kamala Harris and Mike Pence. Speaking now, Senator Harris, followed by Vice President Mike Pence.
Greetings, America. It is truly an honor to be speaking with you. That I'm here tonight is a testament to the dedications of generations before me. Women and men who believed in the promise of equality, liberty, and justice for all. They paved the way for the leadership of Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton. I stand here before you now, speaking these words. I accept your nomination for the Vice President of the United States of America and to a vision passed through generations of Americans, one that Joe Biden shares. Today, that country feels distant. Donald Trump's failure of leadership has cost lives and livelihoods. We are in a nation that's grieving. Black, Latino, and indigenous people are dying and suffering disproportionately. This is not a coincidence. It is the effect of racism. This virus has no eyes, and yet it knows exactly how we see each other and how we treat each other. And let's be clear, there is no vaccine for racism. We have to do the work for George Floyd, for Breonna Taylor, and for the lives of too many others to name. We have to fulfill the promise of equality. Right now, we have a president who turns our tragedies into political weapons. Joe will be a president who turns our challenges into purpose. Joe and I believe that together we can build a beloved community, one that is strong and decent, just and kind. In this election, we have a chance to change the course of history. So let's fight with the confidence in ourselves, a commitment to each other, to the America we know is possible, and to the America we love. Thank you, and God bless the United States of America.
Good evening, America. It is an honor to speak to you tonight from the hallowed grounds of Fort McHenry, the site of the very battle that inspired the words of our national anthem. Joe Biden said that we were living through a season of darkness. But as President Trump said, where Joe Biden sees American darkness, we see American greatness. In these challenging times, our country needs a president who believes in America, who believes in the boundless capacity of the American people to meet any challenge, defeat any foe, and defend the freedoms we hold dear. America needs 4 more years of President Donald Trump in the White House. Stay safe and know that we will be with you every step of the way to support, rescue, respond, and recover in the days and weeks ahead. This is what Americans do.
Now it is time for the much-awaited presidential debate starring the two, Donald Trump and Joe Biden. US President Donald Trump and his rival candidate Joe Biden faced each other one last time on Thursday at Belmont University in Nashville, Tennessee on October 22. Today, our classmates will be demonstrating some of the major yet hilarious segments of the heated debate.
Good evening from the campus of Case Western Reserve University. I'm Chris Wallace of Fox News and I welcome you to the first of the 2020 presidential debate. I can assure you that none of the questions have been shared with the commission or the two candidates. We welcome the Republican nominee, President Trump, and the Democratic nominee, Vice President Biden.
How are you doing, man?
How are you doing?
Mr. President, the Supreme Court will hear a case a week after the election in which the Trump administration, along with 88 state attorney generals, are seeking to overturn Obamacare and to end it.
That's right.
You have spent the last week...
Because they want to give a good health care.
When I finish, I'm going to give an opportunity.
This was absolutely a big thing, Chris. The individual mandate was the worst part of Obamacare.
So my question, sir, is what is the Trump healthcare plan?
Well, first of all, I'm debating you, not him, but that's okay. I'm not surprised. First of all, I'm going with favored nations, which no president has had the courage to do in 47 years of their government. Drug prices are coming down from 80 to 90%. I'm just helping people by cutting healthcare. That's all I'm doing.
I'm about to pick up on one of your points to ask the vice president, which is he points out that he would like to add a public option to Obamacare.
Yes.
And the argument that he makes and other Republicans make is that that is going to end private insurance.
It is not.
If I could start asking the question now, will it end private insurance and create a government takeover of health?
It does not. It's only for those people who are so poor they qualify for Medicaid. They can get that in free in most states. Anyone who qualifies for Medicaid, would automatically be enrolled in the public option.
Hey, Joe, you agree with Bernie Sanders, who's far left on the manifesto, as we call it, that gives you socialized medicine?
Look, hey.
Are you saying that you didn't agree, Joe?
I am not going to listen to him. The fact of the matter is, I beat Bernie Sanders.
Well, that's not by much.
I beat him by a whole hell of a lot.
Not by much.
I'm here standing facing you, old buddy.
If Pocahontas would have left 2 days early, you would have lost every primary you had, Joe.
Look, here's the deal. I got very lucky. I'm going to get very lucky tonight as well.
Oh, really? With what?
And tonight, I'm going to make sure.
With what?
Because here's the deal. The fact is that everything he's saying so far is simply a lie. I'm not here to call out on his lies. Everybody knows he's a liar. He's not smart at all.
First of all, Joe, you're the liar. You graduated last in your class, not first in your class. So don't ever use the word smart with me.
Please.
Mr. President, can you let him finish, sir?
No, he doesn't know how to do that.
Actually, you would be surprised. Go ahead, Joe.
The wrong guy, the wrong night, at the wrong time.
Hey, buddy, listen. You agree with Bernie Sanders and the manifesto.
Will you shut up, man? There is no manifesto number one.
Oh, really?
President,
you agree with Bernie Sanders on a plan that you absolutely agree to, and under that plan they call it socialized medicine. You're going back on your word, Joe Biden.
President,
I'll tell you what, he's not for any help for the people needing healthcare.
Oh well, really, then who is Bernie?
Please, looking at both your records, why should voters elect you president as opposed to President Trump? You have 1 minute uninterrupted.
Under this president, we become weaker, sicker, poorer, more divided and more violent. With regards to being weaker, the fact is that I've gone head to head with Putin and made it clear to him we're not going to take any of his stuff. He is a Putin's puppy. You're the worst president.
The argument,
wait a minute, Mr. Now? President. Your campaign agreed that both sides would get time to speak, okay, sir?
He never keeps his word.
No, that was a rhetorical question.
Can you get back 30 seconds?
Yes, you may have your 30 seconds.
So thirdly, we're poor. We can't be this way. And speaking of my son, the way you talk about the military, the way you talk about them being losers and just being suckers, talks a lot about how you are, Trump.
Oh, really?
Vice President Biden,
the only one you've got right now.
Will you urge your supporters to stay calm while the vote is counted?
Yes, and here's the deal. We count the ballots as you pointed out. Some of these ballots in some states can't even be opened until election day. And if there's thousands of ballots, it's going to take time to do it. And by the way, our military...
Right, Joe. It's already been established. Take a look at Caroline Magny's race.
I asked you. You had an opportunity to respond. Go ahead, Vice President Biden.
He has no idea what he's talking about. Here's the deal. The fact is, I will accept it and he will too. You know why? Because once the winner is declared, after all the ballots are counted, all the votes are counted, that will be the end of it. That will be the end of it. And this guy?
I just want to see an honest ballot count. That's and all.
Shut up, Trump.
I want to see an honest ballot count.
I'm going to leave it there.
Anything Joe does too, don't you, Joe?
He continued in more.
Yes, I do.
President Trump, Vice President Biden, I want to thank you both for participating in the first of three debates. Until then, thank you and good night.
In the general election, citizens of the United States have three votes in total. For the President, House of Representatives, and the Senate. In other US elections, candidates are elected directly by popular vote, but the President and Vice President are not elected directly by the citizens. Instead, the US citizens vote for the electors, who in turn elect the President and the Vice President.
In the Electoral College system, each state gets a certain number of electors based on its total number of representatives in the Congress. There are a total of 538 electoral votes. The candidate that gets more than half, which is 270, wins the election. The President-elect and the Vice-President-elect take the oath of the office. Donald Trump won the last elections due to this electoral college system. In the end, the Biden-Harris administration won the general elections for the United States of America, year 2020, with a total of 306 electoral votes. Crashing.
Hit a wall. Americans, we were getting ready to win this election. And honestly, we did win this election. All the Democrats out there stealing ballots at 4 a.m. in the morning and adding them to their votes. That is how this is not going to work. We will go to the Supreme Court. We will order a recounting in Pennsylvania, in Georgia, and all the other states that we are winning in. Americans, we will win this election. All the Republicans out there, we have won this election.
This brings us to the end of our presentation. Hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.
As we bring our journey of FinCar to a close, we continue to delve deeper into the joys of learning. The excellent presentations and active discussions by our friends is a testimony that the purpose of holistic education has been completely accomplished. We would like to extend our special thanks to Anju Ma'am for instilling the culture of creativity and innovation. Thank you, Ma'am, for entrusting us and giving us the vision to see beyond the textbooks. With a deep sense of appreciation, we thank our loving teachers for their untiring efforts. We would also like to thank all the people who worked behind the scenes to execute this event. Thank you and goodbye.